Zero to Hero by Connell Riley, grade 6. As all superhero stories start, you need an origin. If you haven't guessed, this is a superhero story.
George Logan Stevens, you're gonna be late for school.
I'm coming, I promise.
George Stevens is a scrawny 13-year-old boy who lives in Queens. As George runs to go eat a hasty breakfast, he peeks inside his parents' room and sees his dad sleeping. He concludes that his dad has had a late night again. Ever since Mr. Stevens got his job as a surgeon, George has been lacking a father figure.
Come on, just eat on the way. I'll drive you today.
Oh wait, I forgot my comic book.
Did you hear? They finally found a replacement for Mr. Mechanus.
Took them long enough. He got fired 2 weeks ago. Good thing they did too. He was a little strange. Plus all the science we learned was things about machines. We never learned about physics, chemistry, or electricity. What's his name?
Mr. Riley. Well, we're here. Love you, my little hero.
Mom, I'm not 5 anymore.
Right, sorry. I love you. Have a good day.
Yeah, I love you too. Tell Dad I said good morning when he wakes up.
He really misses spending time with you. You know he can't control it. He really tries.
I know, but sometimes I wish he would try harder.
Bye. I love you.
George's day consisted of his normal classes. George was convinced that this was the boringest day in the whole semester. In his third period of the day, he was proven wrong.
Hello, class. My name is Mr. Riley, and I'm your science teacher. I was informed that you were in the middle of your robotics unit, but I also heard you were in that unit for a whole semester. So today, we'll be starting your new unit, electricity.
George enjoyed this class and discovered that Mr. Riley also loved superheroes. They stayed after school to talk about why Groot is basically a god when George got a text from his mom.
Where are you?
I'm sorry, Mr. Riley. I have to go home. We'll finish this conversation later.
On the way home.
I have to get home.
He pulls out a comic book and starts reading.
Captain America, you're so amazing.
The way George took home was very quiet. He probably saw 2 or 3 people on a busy day, but today it was empty. As George read on about Captain America's achievements, it began to rain.
Oh, no, Dad's comic book!
As George ran and ran, and as the droplets of rain gradually got thicker, he heard thunder.
I have to get home. If I were to get Dad's comic book wet, I would be in so much
trouble. Boom! As a bolt of lightning slithered down from the dark clouds of New York, something changed in George. Something that not only changed him, but his whole life.
Ow! I must have tripped and fallen. I still have to get home.
George quickly walked home. As he approached his front door, he realized he had walked a third of a mile in what seemed like a minute. He concluded,
I must have been daydreaming.
George entered his home and greeted his mother.
Hey, Mom.
Oh, hi, honey. I'm just making dinner.
Hey, Dad. Dad? Let me guess, late night again?
Well, how's Mr. Riley? Is he just as bad?
Actually, no, he's awesome. He really likes superheroes, and we talked for a while about them. That's why I was late.
George went on and on, but suddenly stopped.
What? What is it?
Nothing.
George lied.
I just realized something. I'm going to head upstairs and knock out some homework.
The gap that was left in his life might have been resealed today. George walked up the stairs thinking, not looking where he was going. He bumped the little table where his great-grandmother's vase was. He walked away, not realizing till he heard the table tip over. He got scared out of his mind. He knew he'd be grounded for, well, ever, if he broke that vase. But he had no reason for fear. Why? Well...
It's in my hands. How? What the actual heck? I moved 2 feet in the blink of an eye.
What's that?
I was just talking to myself.
George closed his door and tested his new speed. He set a stopwatch on his phone and ran around his room 10 times. He felt silly doing this, but he had to know. He stopped when he got to 10 times and checked the stopwatch. It was at 15 seconds. George continually pinched himself, saying,
Wake up!
Time for dinner. It's your favorite. Rice, beans, and sausage.
Yum! I'm coming down. I have to be slow.
George awoke the next morning thinking, hoping it was a dream. To test it, he did the same thing he did the prior night. Still 15 seconds. George was filled with confusion and fear.
So confused. I need time to figure this out, but I don't have time. I need to tell somebody. Mom, I'm going to be staying late after school again.
After school.
Mr. Riley, I have something different to talk about today.
As George formed the words, the happiness disappeared from Mr. Riley's face. It was replaced with confusion.
Ah, you got me. Funny joke.
I know you don't believe me, but it feels good to tell someone. It's just, I thought maybe you would believe me.
I do believe you. Because I have powers too.
George was relieved when most people would have been terrified. Mr. Riley disappeared. Then George felt something tapping on his shoulder. Mr. Riley appears again.
Whoa! That's awesome! Here, let me show you what I can do.
He runs around the room.
It feels so good to know I'm not the only one.
George agrees, and for the rest of the time, they tested their powers, limits, and everything in between.
Oh, geez, it's 7 o'clock. I have to get home. Bye, Mr. Riley.
Okay, have a good night. Remember, George, don't tell anybody, because...
Because if anybody knows and you get a nemesis, they'll come for the people you love.
Right.
Good night, Mr. Riley.
On George's way home, he heard an old woman yelling for help.
Somebody help her! Somebody help!
Spider-Man's Uncle Ben's words rang in George's head. With great power, comes great responsibility.
Hey, you! Stop! Give that woman her purse back! Oh, wait. I need a disguise. I'll pull up my hood.
George ran after the man, grabbed a rope in a nearby alley, and tied up the crook.
Sorry, Mamba. This is my first time superheroing. Superheroing? Is that even a word? Well, whatever the word is, stay safe.
George's happiness swelled. It felt good to do good. He ran home and had a normal night.
Mom, this is amazing.
Whoa there, Tiger. Slow down. You don't want to choke. You haven't liked my food like this since, well, ever.
The next morning was a Saturday. George came down the stairs at about 9:15 and made himself a bowl of cereal, let out his dog, Lockjaw, and got the paper. He sat down at the table and ate his cereal.
Robber claims kid with speed saves old woman. Mrs. Ben claims a kid in a hoodie with super speed saves her from a robber. I need a better disguise.
George got to work on a new costume. First, he tried yellow with black.
Too bright.
Then he tried black with yellow.
Too much like Batman.
George was about to call it quits when he saw a blue sweater his dad gave him for his 9th birthday. It was a blue hoodie with a yellow lightning bolt on his chest. He grabbed a ski mask, swimming goggles, and his hoodie. He hid it in his backpack and left.
Let's test this power some more. Where to go? Aha! I'll go to the school and run on the track. Stopwatch, check. Track, check. Disguised. Oh yeah, I forgot.
George had some trouble getting his costume on at first.
Almost there. Got it. Okay, lap time.
George ran 3 laps, but as he was starting the 4th one, he heard someone and took off his costume.
George, is that you? I see you've assembled a costume. I like the color scheme. I've made a discovery about my powers.
What is it?
I've discovered that I can make things invisible, but I have to be touching them.
Quite peculiar.
See, look.
Mr. Riley touched George and something happened.
I'm looking at where I should be, but I'm not there. But I know I'm here because I feel you touching me.
Mr. Riley takes his hand off of George and they reappear.
Whoa!
Again, George and Mr. Riley have a day of research of their powers. At 1 o'clock, George and Mr. Riley decide to part ways and go home.
Lockjaw, I'm home. Good boy. Want to watch some TV? Come on, up on the couch.
The city seems to be under attack. There's a giant robot breaking down buildings. This is something straight out of a movie. We need a hero of some sort.
No! Oh, no! I need to think about this. I mean, of course I should, but I've only been training for a week or so. If I go, I could defeat the robot and save the city. With the possibility of dying. But if I don't, I could stay alive and the city could be destroyed. Or worst case scenario, I could die and the city could be destroyed.
Interrupting George's thoughts on the TV.
I am Dr. Mechanus. Some of you may know me as Mr. Mechanus. You might have heard that my position as a teacher was recently terminated. I'm aware I was not favored by the children or my fellow faculty. But I am the smartest person in this city, maybe in the state. You will regret firing me because now the whole city will pay for it. Nobody can stop me. Mechanus out.
Now I have no choice. I have to stop it. But first I'll need some help.
George ran into the kitchen and opened up the school directory.
Ranker, no. Rick, no. Riley, there we go. Please pick up, Mr. Riley. Come on, come on, come on.
Hello?
Oh, thank goodness you picked up. It's George, by the way. Did you see the thing on TV?
Of course.
Then meet me by the Martins on 5th. I'll be there soon.
George was about to speed out the door with his costume ready, but he remembered his mother would be home soon. He wrote her a note reading,
"Dear Mom, I'm going to be gone for a little while. I'm going to go on a walk. You might see some things on the TV, but no, I'm in no danger. When I get home, we need to have a long conversation. Love, George."
George speeded out the door without hesitation, off to go save the city, defeat the robot, and become a hero. But most of all, he was ready for a new life, void of boring things. He never experienced another day shy of miraculous. He lived like this every day for 3 years, until he hung up the costume. That's a story for another day. End of life. Blindness by Keaton Smith, grade 7. Crystal enters and stops, looking at her left wrist angrily.
By God, out of all the days in September, I choose to sleep in on the student's midterm?
Edward enters and runs into Crystal.
Hey, watch it.
Sorry, Professor.
At least I'm not the only person late.
Sorry, I just was...
Just get to school.
In the classroom, as students Edward, Sophia, and Greta enter.
Sorry I'm late, I just...
Just go to your seat.
I just was...
Okay, class, I hope you turned in your reports.
But you said it was due tomorrow.
Well, does it look like I give a crap about what you have to say? I'm the teacher, and I say it's due today.
Gee, you're so irresponsible.
Shut up!
Now please rise for the national anthem.
All stand except Edward.
Well, Edward, are you going to stand up or not?
No.
Why not?
Well, what do you see when you look outside? What do you see?
Well, all I see is the city.
Well, that's not what I see.
Well, then what do you see?
Well, what I see is failure.
Like what?
I don't know, maybe the failing society? The police listening in on our conversations. The gigantic brick wall that towers over the crumbling city. And finally, the fact that we lie to ourselves every day that we live in a completely normal life inside a brick prison.
You know what? Go out in the hallway and think about...
Police officers 1 and 2 enter.
What is the meaning of this?
Well, we heard over the microphones that one of your students seemed to be making unnecessary comments toward the government, so...
So what?
He must be contained. Well... Who was it?
It was Edward.
Both police officers grab Edward and exit.
I told you they were watching us!
Well, that was eventful. Anyway, it's time to go. I'll see you tomorrow. Oh, Principal.
Well, I just got word that one of your students has been detained.
I can explain.
No need.
Why?
Because this school is about to go under, and I'm not letting you do that. Greta and Sophia enter.
What do you think happened to Edward?
I don't know. Why should I care?
Because he's your brother?
And?
Because he hasn't been at school for days, and when he left school on Tuesday, he was escorted by 2 cops.
So all he has done is red flag my family, and it's probably better for the city that a corrupt thinker like him is in prison.
Okay, class, today we will be studying for your test, but first I'll take attendance. Sophia?
Here.
Greta.
Here.
Edward?
He's absent.
Again.
That's weird. Is this the 5th time this week? I'll go talk to the principal to figure out what's up.
Rumor has it that he's imprisoned or even being interrogated by the Stasi. What do you think happened, Sophia?
Why would I know?
Like I said before, he's your brother. And now a lot of people think you work for the Stasi.
Shut up.
Okay, so it turns out Edward is visiting family out in the country, and class is over. You're dismissed.
At home.
I really need to get my prescription checked. I can't even read books with these glasses.
I'm home.
I swear, a letter came in the mail for you while you were gone. It was from one of your students, named Edward.
Wait, really?
said something about being punished with a death sentence by the Stasi. Don't tell my mom, but instead carry on what I bestowed upon people. Open their minds, become the person you'd want to be. Sincerely, Edward.
My God.
Oh, there's someone at the door.
Crystal walks the door, and Greta and students come running in, panting.
What's the matter? It's Edward. He was right the whole time. We need to do something, and now.
We could try to find his mom. That's the best I got.
Let's go get her.
Students exit, running.
Wait!
Where are you going?
Crystal and Robert exit, running. Enter officers and Sophia, shoulder to shoulder.
So this is the street your professor lives on?
Correct.
Greta, Crystal, and Robert enter.
There she is.
Officer One grabs Crystal by the shoulder.
Get your hand off me.
What makes you so special?
Because I can think.
Like how?
Like the fact I can look around me and see blindness.
How so?
I don't know. Maybe the fact that each day we wake up and ignore the eyesore out our windows. That towers our city to keep us controlled. That's what everything is about. Power. The ability to manipulate, to weaken, to kill. And it took the death of a student to open my mind. So, if you're going to shoot me, then do it.
Okay.
No.
What did you say?
I said no. She's right. The fact that we lie, we manipulate, that we destroy, rebuild, and destroy again and not learn. So it comes down to the free thinkers or governmental superpowers. And you know what? I choose free thinkers. We must learn from what this monstrosity has created. We fight wars to end wars. So if you shoot her, you have to shoot me.
And me.
And us.
So you can either shoot her and you die, or both of you can scram and leave town. So what's it going to be?
Exit Sophia and Officer Warren, both running.
Good. Thank you. For what?
For learning.
End of play. Mysterious by Danny Graham, grade 6.
Mark! I need some ice. My back hurts so badly.
Okay, honey, I'll be right there. What happened to your back anyway?
I was playing at recess with the kids, and I... Never mind, I don't need to explain myself to you.
Okay, I guess so. It's none of my business anyway. I'll just get you some ice.
Phone rings.
Hello?
Are you somewhere secure where you can receive information on behalf of the Bureau of Spy Intel?
Yes, I am.
The BSI will need you. Agent Alicia Mysterious to report to Africa and uncover the secret mines of vibranium that lie at the border of Wakanda.
I accept this honorable mission.
Scene 2. 1 year ago, James Parker Middle School.
Old Miss Mysterious still teaching uninvested seventh graders. And not living out her dreams of traveling the world.
Little does she know, Miss Mysterious is a spy. Well, to be honest, nobody knows that she is a spy, except the BSI, of course.
Okay, class, let's quit the chatter and get back to your U-Town projects.
Miss Mysterious, I don't get this project.
I'm sorry, class, that's the bell. Class is dismissed.
I need some extra help on this project. Can you help me after school?
I'll try to make some time, but I am a very busy person. I don't know about after school.
If you don't mind me asking, what do you do after school that is so important? And why are you always so tired in the morning?
Well, I do mind you asking, and frankly, it's none of your business.
Well, I'm sorry, Miss Mysterious, but it's almost like you're a secret spy or something.
That is an astounding judgment, and it is not true.
Scene 3, at home.
Honey, where have you been sneaking off to after work?
I don't sneak off. Sometimes I just go grocery shopping into the gym.
Sorry, I wasn't trying to accuse you of anything. Sometimes you just act suspicious.
Next time, just remember that I would never lie to you.
Nope.
No, honey.
Good night. Love you.
I love you too. Good night.
Scene 4, BSI headquarters, Scottsdale, Arizona.
What are we going to do about you, Agent Mysterious? I don't think you're as committed as the other agents here, even though you are the best agent we have. You aren't devoted enough. You are still a teacher, aren't you?
Yes, I am still a teacher, but I'm just as committed as the next person. Doesn't being a teacher make me even more valuable? Everyone thinks that I have a normal life, even my family. This is outrageous. I work so hard.
Good. I just wanted to see how bad you wanted to be a spy, and if you were willing to fight to stay here.
Oh.
I have to go. You're insane.
Scene 5. 5, Naples, Florida, at the beach.
Mommy!
I've missed you, kid. I love you so much, honey. I am so excited for vacation.
Me too.
What am I, chopped liver?
Love you too, Dad.
I think we should go boogie boarding. It was my favorite when I was little.
That would be fun. What if we see a shark?
We won't.
We better not.
Mark has an irrational fear of sharks, which usually stops him from going on vacation, which is why this is kid's first time on vacation, to a warm place at least.
I don't think this is such a good idea, guys.
Come on, Daddy-o. It'll all be fine when you get in the water.
You really are a mama's girl.
Yeah, she is.
Don't feel bad, Dad. I love you almost the same.
Oh my.
Phone rings.
Aren't you gonna get that, Mom?
I guess so. I'll be right back.
It's time for your mission. We've sent a car to Naples. Remember, nobody can know about this.
I can't leave. My family's here. They'll be suspicious.
Leave or be left. Forever.
But this isn't fair. No!
What was that all about? You seem pretty upset.
Yeah, you sure did.
It was nothing. I have to leave early, though. The substitute that was covering for me canceled. You two stay here in Florida for some father-daughter bonding.
It's okay. We want to go with you.
No, you really shouldn't go. I beg of you. Stay a while. Have fun. Live lavish.
Okay.
Have fun. Bye.
Your car is here.
Thank you.
Gets in the limo.
So, when does this mission start?
Right now.
Pull off to a warehouse in the middle of the desert.
Is the vibranium kept in this junk hole?
Walks into a warehouse to see an amazing setup with great technology.
Yeah, what a junk hole.
My apologies, sir. This is definitely not a junk hole.
You can say that again.
Can we move on to the reason why I had to leave Florida to come here?
Yes, of course. We need you to pose as an American vibranium buyer and tell us how much there really is in the heart of Wakanda.
Easy. But why do we care about what Wakanda is doing?
And since they have been hiding their supply of vibranium, which is indestructible and could revolutionize the world.
Okay, then. Let's do this.
Scene 6, a hotel room in Florida.
Kid! Where are you?
I'm right here, Daddy.
I wish your mom could be here.
Me too. I miss her so much. Can we call her?
Of course, that's a great idea.
Your call has been forwarded to an automatic voice message system. Leave a message at the beep. Beep.
Hope you had a great day. We miss you and love you. Wish you were here.
Scene 7. Setting changes to the middle of Wakanda, where all of the vibranium is hidden. Mysterious, speaking into an earpiece that has the BSI listening on the other side.
I'm in. What should I do now?
Ask around. Say you are looking for the king.
Okay. Excuse me, kind sir. I'm looking for the king. Do you know where he might be?
I am the king of Wakanda. You must be our American vibranium buyer.
Good day, your highness. You're right. I'm here to take some vibranium off your hands.
Of course you are. Do you have the money?
I do have the money. Where's the vibranium?
It is right here.
Pulls out a fancy briefcase and hands her the case. She hands him the money.
Good day. I hope we can do this again.
We can.
Walks away and gestures her out. Miss Mysterious leaves the building and heads for the warehouse.
Hey, look over there. Fresh meat. Well, she looks like an easy one, too. And where do you think you're going, little missy?
Please, I haven't done anything to you. Would you do me a solid and be nice?
Nah, that's no fun at all.
Agent Mysterious, have you been compromised?
Give me the briefcase.
Hands over the briefcase and runs away.
That was easier than I thought it was going to be.
Scene 8.
What was that? I expected you to come back with the vibranium in hand. What are we supposed to do now? You have ruined this whole mission.
I am so sorry, sir. But those men, they were armed and they could have killed me. I can't take a risk like that when I have a family. I couldn't die while my family thinks I'm teaching. I couldn't die with them thinking I was a liar.
Here we go again with the family crap. When you were a spy, you put spying first. I haven't spoken to my kids in years. I knew you weren't committed enough. This is why we trained you, to deal with things like this. Do not be scared of a gun.
You know what? I quit.
Okay. Goodbye, ex-Agent Mysterious.
Goodbye.
Goodbye, Agent Mysterious. We will miss you.
Scene 9. Miss Mysterious is sitting in her house reading a book, and Kid and Mark walk into the house.
I missed you so much, Mommy.
I missed you too, sweetie.
I love you both so much. I just don't know what I'd do without you.
Miss Mysterious walks into a room by herself.
My whole life, I wanted to be someone special, but I never could. I thought that being a spy might help me, but I'm not even cut out for that. I don't know what to do. I'm miserable. I have to teach kids all day.
The only thing that makes me happy is my family. I must turn my life around, find a new path, a new adventure.
End of play. I See the Sunrise by Anna Kate Nearness, grade 6.
Amelia, Brooke is already in the car.
I'm coming. Have you seen my backpack?
It's in the car, honey. Let's go.
I'm ready.
Scene 2.
Whoa, Amelia, look at the sunrise. It's so pretty.
Looking on her phone.
Yeah, that's so cool.
You didn't even look. Mommy, Amelia's doing that thing again.
Amelia, honey, we talked about this. You only ever look at your phone. What if this is your last day being able to see? Then you'd spend the rest of your life wishing you had looked at the rest of the world.
Nothing is going to happen to me, Mom. Mind your own business, Brooke.
Lady, stop fighting. Okay, we're here. Have a nice day, my lovelies. Bye, Mommy.
Hey, Natalie, wait up.
You never learn.
Scene 3, in science class at lab tables.
Well, class, today we're going to do something very exciting.
Yeah, because science is always fun.
I know, right? Let's be partners. Do you know what we're supposed to do? I wasn't listening.
Oh, yeah. I know exactly what we're supposed to do. Here, you see this acid? And we're supposed to do something like mix the two liquids together.
Sounds easy enough. Let's do it.
Puts on safety goggles and reaches out with another pair.
Here, do you want to put these on?
No, I'm fine. And since when do you care about safety?
Come on, Amelia. I really don't think it's a good idea. At least put your hair up so your hair doesn't burn off.
Jeez, you sound like my mom. Do you have a hair tie?
Natalie reaches out with a hair tie and drops it.
Here, I got it.
Natalie starts to pour acid when Amelia sits up and bumps her arm and gets acid in Amelia's eye.
Oh my gosh, Amelia! Are you okay? I'm so sorry!
Ah! I can't see anything!
Mr. Appleby, we've had an accident with the acid!
Someone call an ambulance! Hello, my student. She had an accident. She can't see anything.
Scene 4, in hospital room.
Oh my gosh. Mom, is that you? I can't see anything.
Come here, baby. Come to Mama. You're going to be okay. The doctors will take care of you. Amelia, are you okay?
Takes Amelia's hands.
Tell me you're okay. How many fingers am I holding up?
Brooke, she can't see. Don't worry. She'll be back to seeing in no time.
A nurse rushes in and mouths some bad news.
No, not my baby. Oh, Amelia.
Am I stuck like this?
She passes out.
Amelia!
Scene 5, 1 year later.
Amelia, are you sure you want to do this? I still really don't think this is a good idea. I mean, school? Never mind. What do you want to do, honey?
Mom, listen to me. I've been cooped up in this house for a year. I need to go out and face the world. I wish for nothing more than to have my vision back. But guess what? It's gone, and it's never coming back. So I'm making the most of it. You think I want to stay blind? I've been trapped. Trapped in this life where I can't see or control anything. So cut it out.
She trips and falls.
Oh, I thought it was my backpack. I'm going to school whether you like it or not.
Oh, honey. I know it's hard, I do, but take things slow, please. Do it for me.
Absolutely not. I have to, Mom. Mommy, please.
Maybe tomorrow. Honey, I need to prepare myself. Why don't you practice your reading?
She walks over to a shelf and picks out a book.
Here.
Can't practice reading Braille forever.
Scene 6, in the kitchen.
What did they say? I didn't really hear it, but I thought that I heard them talking about her.
Flashback to a group of people talking about Amelia in the school hallway.
Yeah. But I heard that she almost had to cut out her eyes, but her insane mother wouldn't let them.
No way. How did she even go blind?
Well, she stared at the sun too long, and then whoosh, it was gone, and she was never to see again.
Really? I heard that you...
Well, you heard wrong. Back to the kitchen.
Yeah, there's no way I'm letting her go back. I feel like I have to do something, though. I can't just let Natalie walk all over my sister. Just don't get involved. To think that they were best friends.
Scene 7, 1 month later at school.
She's a freak, I tell you. A freak.
Natalie, just stop talking about her. It's getting old.
Yeah, what if she comes back tomorrow and she's completely fine?
She won't be fine. She'll never be fine. All she will ever be is the blind girl.
Leave her alone.
Hope, well, look who it is. What do you want?
Natalie, leave her alone. She never did anything to you.
It's not your turn to talk, okay? And you, little Brooke, how's your sister the blind freak? I mean, girl.
That's it. I'm done with you. Everyone's done with you. Stop talking about Amelia. She hasn't ever done anything to you. You're the one that made her go blind. Yeah, that's right. Natalie's the one that took her sight away. Natalie, leave my sister alone or I'll tell everyone that it was you.
I...
Scene 8. 1 month later, with the doctor in a hospital room.
You're kidding me, right? This is amazing! Mommy, I can't believe it! I can't wait to tell Brooke!
I can't believe it! Honey, you'll be able to see again.
Only if you're okay with the procedure. You are okay with the procedure, right?
Ah! Does that answer your question?
Scene 9. 1 day later in the kitchen.
I can't believe it. Amelia, this is amazing.
I know, right? I never ever would have thought this would happen. I didn't even know that surgeries to get your sight back was a thing. Oh, Brooke, in a week I'll be able to see again. To go to school again. To see you again. I can't wait to tell Natalie. She'll be so psyched.
Oh, Amelia, there's something I haven't told you. Natalie, she...
Scene 10, 1 week later.
Honey, when you come out of that room, you'll be able to see again. I just wanted to say you've been so strong and that I love you so much.
I love you too, Amelia.
Mommy, I can't wait to see you. Brooke, I can't wait to see you too.
Scene 11, the procedure.
I wonder what it would be like. You know, color, people, in the sky. Oh, how I miss the sky. I wonder why Natalie would say those things about me. It was her fault in the first place. Well, I guess it was my fault for not wearing those goggles. Oh, how I wonder if I could do it over again. I'd take those goggles and wear them for the rest of my life. Well, maybe not the rest of my life. I remember the day that accident happened. We were driving to the car, and Mom said,
"What if this is your last day to see? Then you'd spend the rest of your life wishing you had looked at the rest of the world."
Maybe not the rest of my life, but the rest of that year.
Scene 12, 2 weeks after the procedure, in the car.
Whoa, look at that sunrise. Look at that sunrise.
Okay, ladies, have a nice day.
Bye, Mommy. Mom, I'm scared.
Honey, everyone's first day of school is nerve-wracking, but...
It's not my first day. It's my first day back.
Fine. First day back, whatever. Go ahead.
Wow, thanks for the pep talk. I'm good. I'm perfectly fine. It will be just like it was before.
Honey, here.
Holds out Amelia's old phone.
I thought you would like to have it.
You know what? I don't think I'll need this. I'm living every day as if it's my last, seeing the world. And I'm not gonna miss any of it with this huge junk of garbage.
Amelia, one more thing.
Wear your safety goggles!
Scene 13, school entrance.
Oh my God! Look! I can't believe it!
I don't believe it!
What's all the commotion about? Is that? No, it couldn't be. Wait. Oh my gosh, there's no way! Is that?
The blind freak? Yeah, it is. Except one thing. I'm not blind anymore.
I can't believe it! I can't believe you're back! I missed you so much!
Yeah, so much that you would talk about me every day? Don't worry. I'm not deaf too. I know all about your little scheme. And about how I lost my vision by looking at the sun too long? You guys didn't believe that, did you?
Oh,
yeah, we did, but we're really sorry.
Don't be sorry. For someone who's blind for a year, I can't stand to look at your face.
Ugh, what a jerk. Don't you agree, ladies?
No, I don't.
Yeah, me too.
Talking badly about someone else while they're not there to defend themselves says more about you than the person you're talking about.
Blackout. End of book. Snowden by Mia Risser, grade 7. A 12-year-old girl and her mom enter.
Mom, you can go now. I'm just going to be in the library for an hour or so. And, like, there'll be other people here, too.
Okay, Ambrosia, I know that. It's just there's supposed to be a huge snowstorm coming in about an hour, and I don't want you getting trapped in there.
Mom, stop worrying. It's just snow.
Okay, Sugar Plum, I'll leave some money with you in case you get hungry. Have fun with Eve.
Ambrosia runs off. A car pulls up in front of the library.
Bye, Dad. See you in a few hours. If anything happens, I'll call you.
Stage goes dark. Lights come back on, and we are in the library. Ambrosia and Eve are sitting at a table gossiping. James is at a computer, and Sydney is reading a book. Hudson is studying for math in the corner.
What?
OMG.
Jeez, can you two be quiet for once?
James walks over to Hudson, and Eve and Ambrosia watch him, and you can hear something along the lines of,
"He's so cute,"
from one of them.
So, Hudson, what's up?
Oh, hi. Nothing much, I guess. Just studying for math.
Mind if I join you? I have a test Monday, and I want to practice.
Yeah, I guess.
Hi, James.
Hey, Ambro.
You know I hate it when you call me that.
Yep, that's why I do it.
You two are so cute. You guys should totally hang out sometime.
Yeah, that'd be cool, I guess.
Ambrosia, you two should talk for a bit, don't you think?
Okay.
Ambrosia and James walk to a table. Eve goes to another table and draws.
Hi, Eve.
Hey, Sid.
I know it's been a long time since we were friends, and I just thought that we should talk again.
Oh, yeah, me too. Sid.
Okay, you go. I'll go first. Ever since Ambrosia moved here, you've been really distant with me and only hang out with the popular crowd. And not to be mean, but you are way too smart to be friends with them.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Hold up. Ambrosia and the popular kids, or whatever you call them, are very nice, welcoming, and smart. I like them. And I think if you got to know Ambrosia and all them, you would too.
Yeah, right.
So, I feel like I never get to talk to you anymore now that school's really kicked into gear.
Yeah, me too. I miss our little chats. I'm so happy I met Eve on the first day. She was so sweet and welcoming to me, and for her to introduce me to all of her friends.
Wait, you do know that Eve wasn't friends with us until you came, right?
What? Who was she friends with?
Sydney?
We hear a crash in the background, and a chair falls over as Eve and Sydney have a girl fight.
I heard that!
Well, I said it out loud.
Ugh, why was I ever friends with you?
Because no one else wanted to be friends with you except me, but oh, as soon as the new pretty popular girl comes along who doesn't know you're not part of that group, you just ditch me.
Oh, snap.
Guys, stop! Get out of my way, princess.
No, you two need to stop. I don't know what has gotten into both of you, but I intend to stop it before it gets worse. Sit, both of you. Okay, so I don't know what's going on here, but I don't like it. Like, at all.
Oops, I missed a call from my dad. I should probably go now. Bye, guys.
Bye, dude.
Hudson walks to the door and opens it.
Guys, I think we're snowed in.
Oh my god, Hudson's right. We're blocked in. This is a travesty. Someone, quick check the other exits. My mom warned me about this.
This one's blocked too.
Yeah, same here.
Yep, no different over here.
We're stuck in a library with books?
It's pronounced library.
Yeah. Guys, it's fine. I'll call someone to come get us out.
Hudson dials number, and then his phone shuts off.
What the? But I just got the new iPhone 16.
Okay.
Just shut up.
Yeah, mine just did too. Wait, Hudson, you said you have the iPhone 16, right?
Yeah, what?
I was thinking of getting a new upgrade soon. Do you like it?
Oh, yeah. I love it. It's so cool. I definitely recommend it. I heard the 17 blows up.
Awesome. I'll...
Boy! Now is not the time for phones. We have to figure out how to get out of here.
For once, I actually agree with the girl.
Okay, that's great that you two are finally agreeing on something, but if you haven't noticed, all the exits are blocked, so I think we should just chill out here while we can. Before all the interviews we get after being stuck in a library, I can almost see it. 5 young children. Stuck in a library. Posted all over the newspapers.
I hate to break it to you, Eve, but there's probably more important issues than 5 kids in a library that you posted in the news.
Way to burst my bubble, Hudson. Guys, I have a better idea. Let's play who can hide from everyone else the longest.
Isn't that called hide and seek?
Yeah, but I thought that hide and seek was a little too kiddish, so I renamed it.
guys, playing a game might actually be a good idea, since we're stuck in a boring library.
It's library!
Maybe we should just get to know each other. I really don't know any of you that well. This could be a great opportunity.
I like this idea. It could be a sort of, like, group chat, but in real life.
That's an odd way of putting it, but okay.
Okay, I'll go first. Well, so as you know, my mom died when I was 5, and I don't really remember her that much. And it's been pretty hard growing up without a mom.
I didn't know that. I'm so sorry, Hudson. I can't believe how hard that must be.
Thanks. I've gotten used to it. Well, it's just tough because my dad is hard on me. That's sort of why I'm so quiet, because I'm afraid I'm going to mess up.
Wow, dude, that's deep. I feel for you, bro. If you ever need someone to talk to, I'm here, man.
Thanks, James.
No problem. I guess I'll go next. I know you all think of me as the hot, popular jock.
You're so modest.
But there's more to me than just that. I like math, and I'm on the Math Leads team.
James, that's really cool. Do you think you could help me with my math homework sometimes?
Sure. I'm surprised by your response.
Why? It's not like that's embarrassing. There are different sides to everyone. Some people like to keep one a secret, and others show each side of their personality.
Thanks. I think this was a good idea.
Okay, guys. I'll go next. So, I don't think any of you guys know why I moved here, do you? Okay, so I moved here because my older brother has a sickness that requires a lot of attention, and we couldn't give that to him in California. So we decided to move closer to my grandparents so they could help out. I was really nervous, but all of you guys made me feel so welcome.
Imroja, I'm so sorry. If you ever need anything, just let me know.
I guess it's my turn now. Okay. So lately it's been really hard for me to make friends ever since me and Eve sort of lost connection. I've just been mean to everyone who would come along.
Oh, Sid, you know I would have been your friend.
Yeah, I was just nervous. I'd mess up or get betrayed again.
Cindy, I'm really sorry. What I did wasn't right, and I hope you can forgive me.
That seems pretty sincere to me.
Thanks, Eve. I really appreciate it.
Guys, I feel horrible. I'm the one that really caused this. If I had known Sid and Eve were friends, I probably would have backed off.
Ambrosia, it's fine. You didn't know. And I think you're really nice. And if it's okay, I want to get to know you better.
Okay, guys, it's my turn. I've always wanted to be considered popular. And when I got the chance, I just jumped on it, without thinking of who I might hurt in the process.
Eve, all of us have had that thought. And I mean, you can't really beat yourself up about it, because you weren't thinking. You also apologized, which shows some character.
I accepted your apology, too.
Both girls stand up and hug.
Guys, I think this went really well. I've never really considered any of you my close friends, but I think I really know you now and can connect with you all.
Yeah.
I think I can speak for all of us when I say getting stuck in this library wasn't so bad.
No, it's library. Oh, now I'm doing it too.
No, guys, my phone turned back on.
Wow, that's fast.
A sudden banging makes them all jump. James gets up and walks toward the door, where the banging came from.
Hey, it's your dad, Hudson.
Well, let him in.
What's the password?
Who in brutin' tootin' tarnation are you?
Not the password.
Let me in.
Not even close.
James.
Hey, kids, I'm here to get y'all home.
Everyone grabs their stuff and leaves the building. Monday at school. James walks over to his friends and starts talking. Shortly after, Ambrosia, Eve, and Sydney walk in. Hudson walks in right after. James walks away from his friends. They look confused when he walks up to Hudson and the girls and slings his arm around them.
Hey there, gang. Let's head to the library.
End of quote.
Yeah.
The Power of Two Sides by Chloe Swank. Grade 6. This is a story about Connell, the sloth, and Joan and Avery, the evil pigs. Joan and Avery are the bad guys. Connell wants to bring them to justice. Connell is not scared of anything, except giant moths. But let's not get started on his personal life. Let's get to the story instead. Once upon a time, there lived a sloth named Connell. Connell lives in Fort Myers, Florida. He lives in a tree. Connell's day job included being a hero and being a professional eater. And his night job, well, included the exact same things. He's a very big eater and sleeper.
Hi. I'm Kam, as they already said. I have two very important jobs, one more important than the other. My life motto is eat today and eat more tomorrow. My favorite movie is Ice Age. Can you guess my favorite character? Well, it's obvious, Sid the Sloth. Well, I think you know enough about me. Let's move on.
Hi, I'm Joan, and this is my twin, Avery.
Hi, I'm Joan's twin, Avery. We live in Fort Myers, Florida as well, and we live in a house. We are the bad pigs, and we do not want to get caught by Connell. He is just so... Well, let's move on.
Avery, should we move today?
I'm good, Joan.
When Avery and Joan get their minds on something, there's a lot of motivating that has to happen for them to get moving. When Avery and Joan have a lot of motivation, there's only one thing that can come in their way, and you will have to stay to find out who.
Avery, there's a big shipload that's coming in tonight. It's full of pig food. Let's go and steal some of it.
I was thinking the same thing once you said a ship full of pig food. It's an all-you-can-eat buffet on a ship. Let's do it, Joan.
Okay, ship is coming in at 9 o'clock tonight.
Okay, good with me. Let me take a quick power nap so I'm all charged for tonight.
Sounds good to me. I'll do the same thing.
Let's get back to who can stop Joan and Avery. The one thing that can stop them is Connell the Good Sloth.
Next time Joan and Avery try to steal something, I will stop them and bring them to justice. I have been waiting for the right time to catch them and put them in jail. For 5 years, ever since I heard they stole that all-you-can-eat food bar.
And Connell did not know how close the chance was going to be. Well, anyway, it's now 9 o'clock, and Joan and Avery are on the move.
Avery, we've successfully gotten the pig food. Now we just need to get back to the storage unit.
Exactly what I was thinking.
Hey, we have runners! Get that food back!
I will catch them, Police Carl.
3 days later.
I am almost there.
Connell is having some slow breaks.
Dude, can I give you a lift to catch the bad guys?
Yes, I would like that a lot, Police Carl.
No problem, Connell. You are one of our biggest heroes here at the police department.
Oh, you're too kind, Police Carl.
Connell got to the criminals, but there was a little twist. Joan and Avery were not at their storage unit. So Connell and Officer Carl drove to Joan and Avery's house, but they weren't there either.
We were at the safe house, Avery. Nobody else knows about the safe house except us, so no one will ever find us.
Are you sure we're the only ones that know?
Wait. Carl, I think there is one more place we can look. The safe house.
So Carl and Connell drove to the safe house in Naples, Florida. When they got to the safe house, well, I'll let them tell it.
Is this the place, Connell?
Yes, this is the place.
So Connell and Officer Carl went to the door.
Joan, I thought you said no one else knew about this place.
No one does. Oh no, I know who it is. It's Connell, the Good Sloth.
Connell and Carl knock on the door again, and no one answered. So they broke down the door and barged in.
Run for that window, Avery.
I can't fit. Joan, wait, never mind. Got it.
As Joan and Avery are running for their van with pig food on their backs, Connell and Officer Carl are trying to find Joan and Avery in the safe house.
I have looked everywhere, Carl. They are not here.
Did you just hear that, Carl?
What was I listening for, Carl?
It sounded like a car engine.
I did hear it, Carl.
Then why are we still here, Connell? Let's get going.
So Connell and Carl left to go bring the pigs to justice.
I think we lost them, Avery.
Same. They are not behind us.
Carl, take the side street. We will cut them off.
While Connell and Carl are on the wild pig hunt for Joan and Avery, Joan and Avery have no worries that they are going to get caught by Connell and Carl.
I see them, Carl. Take a turn at the next street.
Yeah, will do, Connell.
Joan, is that them?
Is that Connell I see?
Is it? I can't really see anything that way because of all the buildings.
It is them.
Joan and Avery have seen Connell and Carl right on their tails. They know they had to do something so they would not get caught.
Next turn and we will get them.
Okay.
I see them. They're gaining on us, Joan.
It is okay. Do not worry. I have a plan. It involves you.
Connell and Carl have their eyes on Joan and Avery. But Joan and Avery have a plan. I'll let you hear it.
Come close, and I will tell you my plan.
Okay.
So, do you see that barn up there?
Yes.
I'm going to pull over, and I'm going to get out of the van, and so are you. Do you follow me so far?
Yes.
Okay. I will go into the barn, and you will stay on the lookout. You will use your snort alert to tell me they are coming. Then, they will see the arrow pointing towards the barn, and I will snort, so they come into the barn. Do you follow me so far?
Yes, I follow.
Good. Let me keep going.
Okay. Carry on.
Okay. Going on. So, they will come into the barn. I will be hiding in a haystack. I set up a trap inside the barn, a few steps in, and when they come in, they will step in it, and they will get caught. And then, I will jump out from the haystack, I'll come out to get you, and we will leave. Cool?
Okay. I will get in my spot.
Okay. And I will go get in my spot.
Avery and Joan are getting into their hiding spots to catch Carl and Connell. While Carl and Connell were looking for a spot to park, so they can go and catch Joan and Avery.
I saw them go in that barn.
Wait. I think we should make someone go in before us. Just in case they set up a trap.
Good idea, Carl. Criminals like this always pull those kinds of stunts.
Okay, Well, those people look good. They can do it. Let's go ask them.
Okay, let's go.
Connell and Carl walk up to these complete strangers and ask them if they would walk into the barn.
Excuse me, can I ask for a favor?
Yes?
What kind of favor?
The kind of favor that brings two criminals to justice.
Of course. It involves two criminals going to jail, so of course.
No, it could be dangerous.
It involves two people going to jail that should already be in jail, so we are doing it.
Fine, honey. Sure, we will do it.
Okay. You will walk into the barn, and there will most likely be a trap set up right when you walk in. You will get caught. Here's a knife. When you get caught, you can use the knife to cut yourself free.
Okay, we'll do. We are so glad we can help.
The two strangers grab the knife and start to walk toward the barn. They are thinking and thinking about what to do and if they should go in. The wife is still trying to convince her husband this is the right thing to do.
Sweetie, it's going to be okay. We're not going to get hurt.
How do you know that, sweetie?
I don't. But a police officer and a hero are not going to put us in any harm.
Okay, I guess. Let's do it.
The man and woman walk into the barn and get caught in the trap. Connell and Carl are hiding behind a tree looking for when Joan and Avery come prancing out of the barn, thinking that they are not going to ever get caught.
This is perfect, Carl. They will never see us.
Well, you were the brains behind all of this.
I couldn't have done it without you.
Now, let's take it to what is going on in the barn.
Carl and Connell just entered the barn, Avery.
Good. Our plan is falling right into our hands.
Yes, it is.
We are in the barn. Be really quiet.
Okay. I agree.
They're almost to the trap. Get ready to run.
I'm always ready.
The man and the woman got caught in the trap, and Joan and Avery ran out of the barn and almost got to their car until...
Gotcha.
I will finally bring you pigs to justice.
I'll take them from here. I'm taking you two back with me.
Honey, where's the knife?
It's in my pocket. Let me grab it.
Okay. Cut us free.
Done.
The man and the woman are now free and played in the act of putting two criminals in jail. Joan and Avery are in their jail cell for the rest of their lives.
Nope.
Connell feels like his life is complete, and Carl is so happy that Joan and Avery are finally in jail. End of play. John Doe by Jessica Chen, grade 7. Scene 1. Polly, a 6-year-old girl, is sitting in her desk, waiting for class to start. Her classmates are also at their desks. Miss Newman walks to the front of the class.
Okay, lovelies. Let's start off this wonderful spring Monday by sharing what we did over the weekend. Belle, why don't you start us off?
Oh, well, over the weekend, my mommy and I went shopping for eggs, and she also let me get a piece of candy.
That's nice. Finnegan, what did you do?
I played with my neighbors until my Aunt Trudy told me to take a nap.
Polly, how about you?
Well, on Saturday I played with my friend, Bailey Pips, and they showed me how to find some blue acorns in the attic to make blue cupcakes. Then, on Sunday, we made the blue cupcakes, but Bailey Pips started growing fur on their wings from eating too many cupcakes.
Blue acorns don't exist, Polly.
Yeah, Polly. You can't just get blue acorns when acorns are brown.
Well then, how did Bailey Pips get them. Bailey Pips isn't real.
Bailey Pips is real.
Okay then, let's just take a deep breath and...
A knock is heard on the classroom door.
Oh, our special guest is here.
Miss Newman opens the door, and a 20-ish looking man enters the classroom.
Everyone, I'd like you to meet Mr. Doe. He'll be my teaching assistant here for a few days. Why don't we all give our attention to him so he can introduce himself?
Hello, everyone. My name is John Doe. I'm here to observe and help out a bit for a few days. I will look forward to getting to meet you all and learning from this experience.
All right, then. Let's continue making our All About Me posters, and Mr. Doe and I will be walking around to help with anything you might need.
The class gets their supplies and start to work on their posters. Polly sees John Doe walking by and decides to introduce herself.
Hi, Mr. John Doe. I'm Polly. My favorite color is strawberry, and I like to eat blue cupcakes. Say, do you like how my poster is looking?
Well, nice to meet you, Polly. Your poster looks very interesting.
Thank you. I wrote down Paulina Rose Marie Jackson as my title because it's my full name. I don't know why my parents bothered to give me such a long name. It seems like whenever they want to calm me down, it's already past 12 bajillion hours because it takes so long to say my name. I mean, they do only call me Paulina Rose, but that's still not as short and simple as just Polly. I think they could save a lot more time if they just said Polly.
He grabs a chair and sits down next to her.
My mother's name was Paulina.
Oh, well, that's weird. Why would a person with a fun name like Paulina Doe name their kid with such a boring name like John? Is your real name even John? You don't look like a John.
My grandparents named me.
Well, that still doesn't make sense. Why would two people interesting enough to name their daughter Paulina give their grandson such a boring name?
Well, they didn't actually name me John.
Then what did they name you?
You don't need to know.
But I want to know. I won't judge you if it's an ugly name.
It doesn't matter.
Yes, it does. Why won't you tell me?
You should work on the rest of your poster.
He gets up and leaves.
You know, Polly, you shouldn't ask people such personal questions. My mommy says that all the time.
Well, someone's name isn't a personal question, though. It could be to him, but it might not be.
Well, you don't know for sure. So, I'm not talking to you because you're rude and you ask too many questions.
They angrily turn away from each other and continue working. Scene 2, the next day, in the classroom. The students start to work on their All About Me posters. Polly starts to write in the section about Bailey Pips. John Doe comes by and looks at her poster.
Bailey Pips is my best friend. They have fairy wings, and they love the color blue. Bailey Pips seems nice.
Yeah, they really are. Yesterday, when I got home, they taught me a flower song to grow flowers in my hair. Bailey Pips likes to put flowers in their blue nightcap.
Why they?
What do you mean?
How come you referred to Bailey Pips as they?
Well, Bailey Pips didn't like any of the genders they saw, so they just have no gender.
How come they got to decide?
Because Bailey Pips was created by a rainbow. The rainbow let Bailey Pips decide what they wanted because the rainbow couldn't decide themselves. Bailey Pips didn't like any of the genders, so now they have no gender.
Oh. Well, why couldn't the rainbow decide?
Because it's a rainbow.
Did Bailey Pips name themselves?
Yeah. Are you going to tell me your name?
Maybe.
Scene 3. It's lunchtime outside, and Polly is sitting away from the other students near a tree, talking to Bailey Pips. Bailey Pips only exists in Polly's imagination. Only Polly can see and hear Bailey Pips.
Bailey Pips, what do you think Mr. John Doe's real name is?
I think it might be something really embarrassing, like Adolphus or Goldilocks.
But why would he go by John? John is such a boring name.
Maybe he just likes boring names. The rainbow first wanted my name to be Blue, but that was too boring.
Yeah, maybe.
You want a piece of my blue cookie?
Yes. Thank you.
Scene 4, the next day. Everyone has finished their posters, and they are to present them today. John Doe goes over to Polly to check on her poster.
Did I spell anything wrong? Do the colors look nice enough?
Well, let me see.
As he bends over to see the poster, a card bearing his name and a photo of him falls out of his pocket.
Ooh,
What's that?
She picks it up and reads the card.
Jane Doe. Wait, is this you, Mr. John Doe?
Oh, that must have, I...
He takes the card from her and shoves it in his pocket as he proceeds to the next student.
Jane?
All right, everyone, let's start our presentations. Remember to show us everything about yourselves on the poster.
Scene 5. Everyone has finished presenting and are getting ready to go home. John Doe peeks out from the classroom and waves Polly in.
Your name is Jane?
Look, Polly, you're still young and might not even know about this yet, but I guess I can't leave you unanswered. I used to be a woman, but that didn't feel right for me, so I went through a transition, and now I'm a man.
So, you were a girl, and now you're a boy.
Yes. Polly, you are a bright young girl, and I really hope that fact doesn't change the way you look at me.
The rainbow said that Bailey Pips could be like that. The rainbow also gave Bailey Pips the choice to be who they wanted.
The rainbow seems great.
I guess your name doesn't actually matter.
Why not?
Because you're still the same person. I just know a little more about you now.
End of play. This Small Apartment by Eden Blakemore, grade 7. It's a small apartment, and the front doors are at the end of a hallway. The hallway leads into the living room. The living room has a blue couch with stains and little rips on it. A dark wood coffee table in front of the couch is covered in books. A small TV is on the coffee table. The kitchen is behind the couch. It's a gray tabletop. There are doors behind the TV that lead to two bedrooms and a bathroom. Adam opens the door and walks in a little and laughs at Danny sitting on the couch just as he left him, watching.
Hey, have you moved at all since I left?
Unless you count getting up to grab another book, then no. I'm perfectly happy to do nothing all day, unlike you.
Was that meant to be an insult?
No, just an observation.
You hungry?
'Cause I sure am. Do burgers sound good? There's that one place that just opened on Burke Street.
So where have you been? 'Cause I'm pretty sure that isn't your gym bag. And you couldn't have been at a class because all your books are in your room.
I thought you said you hadn't moved.
Just like you said you were going to the gym.
Well, if we're interrogating each other, where have you been running off to at night? Because you sure aren't here.
That's none of your business.
Then why is where I went your business?
Because I asked first.
Real mature of you.
Well, where were you?
Where were you?
The TV blares on a news channel. Both boys turn to watch it.
Yesterday, there was yet another fight between Catalyst and the Captain. The Captain has yet to make an appearance to explain why this has happened and what repercussions the villain has to face. Their fight destroyed a whole three blocks.
The TV shows a clip of the fight.
Why do you think they're always fighting?
Who?
Catalyst and the Captain.
How am I supposed to know?
Just think for a second. They fight almost every other day over stupid things and hurt each other for stupid things. I just don't get how they live like that.
It's what they do. It's what they know to do. It's what they've been doing for years. I don't know if they'd know to talk to each other any other way. Kind of reminds you of us, doesn't it? Always fighting over stupid things, but we keep talking and living with each other.
Yeah.
So, how about that burger? I'll go grab the keys. They're in your bag, right?
Danny walks up to Adam's bag and unzips it. Adam walks into his room to grab his coat.
Hey, what's this? You part of a costume club or something?
Hey, don't go into that!
Runs to Danny and grabs his bag, only to see Danny already holding up his costume.
What's this?
Nothing. Let's just go, okay?
No!
Attempts to grab the costume.
You're the guy, right? That's where you were today. And all those other days you weren't at the gym. You were out beating people up.
Yeah. Is that what you want to hear? That I go and beat up guys for reasons I don't even know?
Danny walks into his room and walks out holding a costume.
You're not the only one that does things for reasons he doesn't even know.
Adam grabs the costume out of his hands.
You're joking.
Sorry to break it to you, but...
You are? That means I beat up my best friend every other day? I'm going to be sick!
Adam runs into the bathroom and Danny follows him.
Hey, it's okay. I do it too. It's not like I don't pack a punch.
You don't.
Well, that's just me.
Our friendship's screwed, isn't it?
Probably.
So how did you become...
They sit down on the couch, not looking at each other, and staring straight ahead.
When I was younger, I was scrawny and sort of dumb, and that attracted a whole lot of bullies. So I started to try and get smarter, thinking it would stop the bullies, but as they soon found out and should have expected, it made it 10 times worse. I started losing myself in books and making imaginary friends. My dad started to get sick of me coming home covered in bruises. My mom started to get sick. It didn't help her health to be constantly worried about my health. The worse the bullying got, the worse her health got. My dad blamed me, and I thought, it's my fault.
Her health had nothing to do with the bullying. It wasn't your fault. There was nothing you could have done.
If I stopped the bullying, or at least hit it better, maybe she wouldn't have died as quickly. Anyway, my dad started teaching me how to fight and defend myself. He encouraged me to fight back and be ruthless when fighting, so once I started fighting back, I couldn't stop. I finally felt powerful. I started getting in trouble with the cops, so I used an alias and a costume to beat up bullies. Then you came along, and you started to beat me up when you saw me beating up a couple of guys that I saw beating up a scrawny kid.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. From my perspective, it looks like you were beating him up for money or something selfish like that. God, I'm such a jerk. I've been beating you while you've been trying to do good.
Yeah, I never understood why the one beating someone up unprovoked caused you to be a hero, but me beating someone up completely provoked made me a hero. How did you start doing this full time?
Do you want a backstory or a summary?
Well, I shared my backstory, so now it's your turn.
I grew up in a small Midwestern town where football is the lead and every other sport's the supporting cast. My older brother was quarterback of the football team. My younger sister was the smartest in her class. I also was the middle child, which was not good for my self-esteem. As I was growing up, I tried to be better than both of them, be the smartest in my class, and also be the star football player. I ended up being the second best in everything. I never talked to my parents about it. They would baby me and my siblings would tease me. When I saw you that one day hitting those guys, I thought I could finally be best at something. My parents would give me attention and I would finally be something that no one else was. A superhero.
Well, what are we supposed to do now?
What do you mean?
Well, we can't go on almost killing each other, can we? And the public will be curious if we suddenly stop making appearances, and I'm pretty sure you enjoy what you're doing, even if you now know you were actually beating up your best friend and roommate.
God, I don't know. You have any ideas, oh great catalyst?
We could keep on doing what we're doing, but you pay for my hospital expenses.
I sent you to the hospital?
Yeah, once or twice, but don't worry, the injuries were only minor.
How hard do I even punch?
Never mind that. So, do you have an idea or what?
You could help me find the villains or whatever and I'll beat them up.
Okay, that sounds fine.
How long have you been doing this?
2 years or so? You?
Ever since I saw you beat up that guy. And we've been living together for how long?
3 years, I think? Why?
Danny, think about it. We've been hurting each other for years and haven't noticed. Don't you think that's a little pathetic?
Well, I just try not to think about it.
How?
I like to think we've been paying such close attention to each other's good attributes that we ignore the bad ones. And that we've been too concerned about each other's injuries to wonder where they came from.
They sit in silence, not once moving, just staring ahead at the blank TV screen.
You still hungry?
Yeah, starved.
Good, because I still want that pizza.
Adam stands up and grabs his keys, while Danny grabs his coat. Together, they walk out the front door of their small apartment. End of play. Wow.